de la Secretaría de Acción Social de la Universidad de Costa Rica y de un gran número de organizaciones agricultoras, ecofeministas, campesinas e indígenas que conforman la campaña Pura Vida sin Transgénicos. Reciban un cordial saludo y el agradecimiento por llenar triplemente este auditorio el día de hoy. Vamos a iniciar con las palabras del doctor Luis Felipe Arauz, decano de la Facultad de Ciencias Agroalimentarias de la UCE.
Bienvenidos, bienvenidas, bienvenida doctora Bandana Silva a esta tarde tan especial, a esta tarde realmente memorable, donde la universidad se engalana con una huésped de lujo, una huésped realmente que nos llena de orgullo a esta casa de estudios. La universidad es fuente de pensamiento libre, fuente de discusión, y parte de su quehacer es justamente el quehacer científico, la ciencia independiente, sin ataduras a intereses que no siempre son los más convenientes para el desarrollo de este país, sin ataduras e intereses que no siempre son los más convenientes para la agricultura y para la soberanía alimentaria de este país. Por eso nos sentimos orgullosos de tener acá a la doctora Bandana Silva, quien va a disertar sobre el movimiento Semillas de Libertad y la lucha contra los transgénicos. Gabriela Arquedas va a ser el primer dato de enseñanza de Bandana, entonces yo no voy a hablar mucho sobre ella. Basta decir que es una persona muy destacada a nivel mundial, que ha recibido numerosos premios internacionales de Naciones Unidas y otras organizaciones, y en particular recibió en 1993 el premio al sustento bien ganado, también conocido como Premio Nobel Alternativo. Ella es una luchadora contra las políticas neoliberales de globalización en favor de los derechos de los pueblos, denunciando que la codicia de las corporaciones usurpan los recursos naturales como la tierra, el agua, y violan los derechos fundamentales de la gente. La lucha de Bandana cobra especial relevancia en estos tiempos en que la agricultura campesina en todo el mundo y en nuestro país ha sido menospreciada en favor de una agricultura industrial que hoy atenta contra nuestro medio ambiente, nuestra seguridad alimentaria y nuestra cultura. Quisiera, dentro de esta bienvenida, comentar sobre algunas frases de la doctora Bandana Silva. Una de ellas dice: las semillas son nuestra madre, guardar las semillas es un acto político. Piensen que ustedes que en el último año, durante todo el debate que se ha dado en este país sobre el tema del maíz transgénico, los que han promovido el maíz transgénico han tratado por todos los medios de que el debate se mantenga dentro de lo científico, dentro de las ciencias biológicas, dentro de lo científico, entre comillas. Y bueno, ahí el debate también presenta muchísimas evidencias científicas para tener preocupación por todos los cultivos transgénicos. Pero además, a quienes han presentado otros tipos de argumentos dicen, casi en forma peyorativa, que eso no es científico, que eso es político. Y claro, lo dice muy claro la doctora Bandana Silva, guardar las semillas es un acto político. Pero además de un acto político, es un acto profundamente ético. Es un acto que proviene de nuestra profunda convicción de que nuestra madre tierra, de nuestras semillas, de las tradiciones de nuestros campesinos, es que va a depender, depende y ha siempre dependido la soberanía y la seguridad alimentaria de este planeta. Quisiera comentar otra frase que me encontré ahí, que me parece muy interesante y que es del libro de Bandana del año 2001, que se llama Biopiratería, el saqueo de la naturaleza y el conocimiento, que dice: la aplicación de derechos del continente intelectual a las semillas, al material vegetal y a los sistemas de conocimiento indígena supone menospreciar los derechos de las comunidades locales y socavar su participación en la protección de la biodiversidad. Vean que ahora nos hemos casado muchísimo con este tema de la propiedad intelectual, y casi lo damos como una verdad absoluta en la propiedad intelectual sobre la forma de vida. Creo que todavía hay muchísimo espacio para la discusión, y la academia debería ser justamente el sol donde se da ese espacio de discusión sobre estos temas. No podemos, nos dice Bandana, permitirnos que la semilla se vea reducida a un monocultivo y a un monopolio, que es lo que está ocurriendo. Sin embargo, hay esperanza. Luchas como las de Bandana dan esperanza. Esta convocatoria nos da esperanza. El esfuerzo que han hecho los organizadores, a quienes agradezco, nos da esperanza. Estudiantes, el futuro de este país, algunos de mis estudiantes acá, de quienes me siento profundamente orgulloso, con la esperanza. Y como nos dice Bandana, no es inevitable que las grandes empresas acaben controlando nuestras vidas y gobiernen el mundo. Tenemos la posibilidad real de determinar nuestro propio futuro. Tenemos la obligación ecológica y social de asegurarnos que los alimentos de los que nos nutrimos no sean una cosecha robada. Esto es una frase del libro de Bandana Chiva, Cosecha Robada, el secuestro del suministro mundial de alimentos. Con eso, reitero la bienvenida, el agradecimiento a Bandana por haber compartido con nosotros y por seguir compartiendo con nosotros. Y voy a parar aquí esta presentación para que pueda continuar.
En vista de que vamos a hacer dos conferencias, gracias a la generosidad de la doctora Chiva, la semblanza que les voy a presentar más dentro de su vida, y en realidad lo que quisiera es contextualizar esta visita de la doctora Chiva, esta reunión, con respecto a la situación que estamos viviendo en Costa Rica. Yo creo que todas las personas que están acá sentadas y que están afuera, pues conocen la trayectoria de la doctora Chiva con detalle. Solo voy a señalar que no solamente es una activista política, una ecofeminista, sino que es una rigurosa científica. Y esto es importante para el espacio en el que estamos, que es el espacio universitario, recuperar la rigurosidad científica, la autonomía del pensamiento, saber defender este espacio contra ideas colonizadoras como las de la OMPI y las de la Organización Mundial del Comercio. La lucha dentro de la universidad por defender la libertad del conocimiento es una lucha muy dura. Somos pocas personas que estamos dando esta lucha dentro de la academia y necesitamos del apoyo de todos y todas ustedes. Les comento que el próximo congreso universitario se va a presentar ponencias sobre esto y será muy necesario pues, contar con la compañía de todos y todas acá. Quiero reconocer el aporte del Consejo Universitario de esta universidad en su sesión ordinaria número 5704. Apoyó la exigencia hacia la Corregio del estudio riguroso para saber si se podía liderar un maíz de Monsanto, un maíz transgénico que se quería cultivar acá. Entonces el Consejo Universitario tomado una posición importante en defensa de la biodiversidad y en contra de los mecanismos colonizadores de las corporaciones. Creo que el Consejo Universitario ha sabido escuchar también la voz autónoma del pueblo costarricense, de los habitantes de este país, de todas las nacionalidades, de todos, en el espectro ideológico que nos encontramos acá, que hemos dicho que no queremos cultivos transgénicos acá, y por eso hay un proyecto de ley presentado en la Asamblea Legislativa para declarar una moratoria en el cultivo de organismos genéticamente modificados. También en el marco de la lucha para que se apruebe esa ley, es que la doctora Shiva está acá, un país cuyo territorio en un 86% se ha declarado territorio libre de transgénicos, que es algo impresionante, no solo en la historia de Costa Rica, sino en la historia de América Latina. Y en la campaña que ha liderado la doctora Shiva por la libertad de las semillas y la democracia de la tierra, nosotros también, nosotras, nos hacemos eco de esa campaña, y la doctora Shiva se hace eco de nuestra lucha en Costa Rica. Sin agregar más, entonces quiero dejarles a todos y todas con las palabras de la doctora Vandana Shiva.
Saying something is absolutely essential about otherwise national security is threatened. And in the 80s, these agrochemical and poison companies, and war companies, mutated themselves into the seed industry through genetic engineering. They were very clear about it. I was invited to a meeting where they were present, 1987. It was a conference on the laws of life, on what should be the laws that govern life. Some of us who came with our history in the ecology movement, that the laws of life are laws of the earth, they're the laws of nature, they're the laws of diversity, they're the laws of rejuvenation. The industry said, we need to small. We have to get bigger. And those of us who get bigger will be the ones who have the largest number of patents and intellectual property in their hand. And the only way to get patents on life forms and seeds and biodiversity is to put in one gene, a toxic gene, and then claim you are basically the creators. Because what is a patent? A patent is a claim to invention. And the privilege through that right of allowing anyone else from making, using, developing, whatever is patented. When it comes to transgenics and patents related to transgenics, in effect, the claim is no farmer can succeed. Farmers make seed, and farmer grows the plant. They also harvest the seed. Some of the food is eaten, some of it is saved the seed. And Monsanto is on record. In 1995, when the World Trade Organization was established to say, we wrote this law, we wrote the law of patenting in the WTO. It's Article 27.3b of the World Trade Organization, TRIPS Agreement, the Trade Related Intellectual Property Rights Agreement. And the reason it's called Trade Related is because my government, there's nothing about trade in this, it's about monopolies. And how patents are governed should be left to national democratic institutions. But they wrote the law. And as they said, we were the patient, the diagnostician, and the physician all in one. As a patient, they said, we are patients because farmers save seed. So Monsanto was falling sick. Because farmers were saving seed. They were physicians by saying farmers should be stopped from saving seed. So from the 80s to now, all the energy of the old war industry has gone on pushing transgenics in order to own life and criminalize farmers who save seed. They thought they'd do it by getting transgenics all over the world, but most people don't want transgenics. Most of the world is transgenic free. Most of the world. Very few countries grow transgenics. There are only four crops that account for most of the genetic engineering. Corn, soya, canola, cotton. There are only two traits. Bt toxin, putting a poison into the plant and let the plant produce its own pesticide, or putting a toxin into the plant to resist the herbicide of the same company, so they sell more chemicals and they sell more seeds. But this was supposed to save the world from hunger. I remember in 85, I was at a debate, and they said, we never have to worry about pollution anymore, because with transgenics, we will grow food on toxic dumps, on the moon and on Mars. And they said they'd have every trait, they'd have crops with nitrogen fixing, they'd have all kinds of nutritious crops. None of it has happened. We have two applications, both of which are spreading toxins. Pesticide use has gone up, herbicide use has gone up, and because this is not based on science, it's based on the false assumption that plants are machines, they're like Lego sets. You know, children play with Legos. You move a red block here, you move a blue block there, and you think that's what you can do with plants. But that childlike thinking, not in innocence but in ignorance, is so contrary to how GMOs have actually performed. 2 years ago, we did a study, because there's only one organization that releases global studies. It's called the ISAAA, International Society for the Acquisition of Agricultural Biotechnology Applications. It's a biotechnology industry crowd. And their crowds always go like this. And it's all success, success, success. So we said, let's really find what's happening on the ground. So we asked scientists and movements around the world to tell us what was happening and write a report. And at the end of it, the only title we could give is the GMO Emperor Has No Clothes. It's like the naked emperor who walked down the streets, and because the weavers who had sold a myth said only the smart people and intelligent people will see the clothes. So no one wanted to look stupid. And everyone clapped at the emperor's new clothes. It was only a little child who hadn't been brainwashed, who didn't have to say what everyone expected, just said what was true, but the emperor has no clothes. The reality of GMOs is not just that they fail. The reality is that they're spreading all kinds of pollution. The first pollution is genetic pollution. On the one hand, GMOs can only be embedded in the pie of agriculture that is symbolized by our pineapple and banana plantations. It can only be part of a monoculture industrial system. But then, because plants pollinate, the wind pollinates, the toxic traits of the GMOs spread. And normally, in environmental law, we have a principle: the polluter should pay. If a company throws toxics into a river, they are fined on the grounds of water pollution. If a factory puts out air pollution, they're fined. If your vehicle puts out air pollution, you're fined. But in the case of transgenics, because they are linked to patterns, the polluter gets paid. And this happened with the case of a Canadian farmer, Percy Spicer. He used to grow canola seed. His field was contaminated. Monsanto sent detectives to collect samples from his field. And then they did the DNA test and said, are Roundup resistant genes are in your crop, so you're a thief. And he said, if your Roundup resistant genes are in my crop, you're a polluter. And more than that, you're a trespasser. How did you come into my field and collect samples without my permission? And the lower court at the state level ruled that intellectual property is a higher form of property than the property in land. So Monsanto, to defend its intellectual property, can trespass on anyone's land. We supported Percy to go all the way to the Supreme Court. Monsanto had wanted $200,000 as a fine for intellectual property violation. The Supreme Court struck down the fine, but it said, once we accept patenting, these are the consequences. Because once Monsanto owns the genes, then the occurrence of those genes anyway, even through pollution, is intellectual property theft. And the lawyer in Percy Spicer's case informally said in the corridor, if transgenics will be spread through pollution, that is what we will do. Many countries, that's how transgenics are introduced. I used to advise the government in Brazil. They were GMO free. Monsanto brought in the seeds, got farmers to cultivate, and then they started to say, now these farmers should have a right to grow GMOs. And they subverted the GMO free status of Brazil. The second kind of pollution is the pollution of our knowledge system. As the Dean just mentioned, knowledge is for sharing. Intellectual property rights block the exchange of knowledge. But because GMOs and transgenics are basically for collecting royalties, not for feeding the world, they influence can in fact get money from doing nothing. You know, it's like a landlord builds a house, and then you sit back and the person who works and slogs, if it keeps paying you rent. If I came into this auditorium and I said, because I brought this notebook with me, I have created something new in the auditorium, in the university. And now I should be treated as the maker of the auditorium, the architect and the landlord, and all the students should pay me a fees. The president would kick me out. But in life we have allowed those who move a gene to be treated as the creators and makers of life, to whom everyone must pay a rent. I joke sometimes and say GMO means God move over. We are the creators. Pay us the royalties. The consequences of this kind of knowledge pollution start to affect our university systems. Because the discrepancy is so huge. A Monsanto which makes $2.2 billion out of the Brazilian peasants, 200 million out of the Indian peasants who are in cotton. Around the world, they're talking about $1 trillion just in royalty collection. Just in royalty collection. Now with that kind of money, it's very easy for them to pay extra for those in the university system and in research who will toe their line of carrying on a mechanistic paradigm at a time where we know better. And the scientists who do the real science of working out how organisms work, what's the impact of GMOs, how agroecology works, are constantly marginalized. I have been to universities where basic biology departments have been shut down and there are only biotechnology departments. Only biotechnology departments. Using a science paradigm and a technology that is so primitive. It's primitive in its thought because the paradigm is based not on self-organization as we recognize life is. It's based on the world as a machine which has to be managed from outside. It's a paradigm that doesn't recognize or know interconnection, but can only work with separation. It's a paradigm that does not understand the impacts and refuses to assess the impacts. The technology itself is very crude. Our societies have bred such amazing biodiversity through knowing the plant and the system. In India, our peasants bred 200,000 varieties of rice, your corn varieties, all your different kinds of fruits and vegetables. They're a result of human intelligence working with nature's intelligence in coordination and breeding. Genetic engineering that is not a breeding technology. What it says is, because we work at the genetic level, we are accurate and we are fast. You're fast in shooting a gene, but that speed in the direction of ignorance is not a game. Because you're shooting in the dark, you have to add antibiotic resistance markers, viral promoters, all kinds of things. Every one of those transformations is evidence that the technology is crude. They don't know what they're doing. And then they claim they know what they're doing. In any case, they introduce the gene into existing plants, which are bred by public breeders or by farmers. So they yield the characteristics, don't come from genetic engineering, there's only poisons that have come from genetic engineering, because as a crude technology, it can only introduce traits where a single gene expresses a toxic trait. Most valuable traits, the taste, the quality, the nutrition, the yield, the fragrance is all very complex. It's multigenetic. Multigenetic transformation cannot be achieved by shooting a gene. It can only be achieved through working with the integrity of the plant and the intelligence of scientists and farmers. The knowledge assault is getting very, very deep. And I noticed that science is being replaced by public relations. Barrett-like repetition of people will die if we don't have transgenics. How can people die if you don't introduce a crop with lower yield? How can people die if you don't spread toxic genes? How can people die if you don't introduce a so-called golden rice, which is thousands of times less efficient in providing vitamin A than a biodiversity, or a GMO banana with iron enrichment, which is 7,000 times less efficient than the biodiversity we have, the knowledge women have in cooking and growing these diverse foods. A monoculture, agriculture means a monoculture food system. So much food is reduced to corn and soya. And we are the land of beans, because we are vegetarians. Our beans, the diversity is gone down, the scarcity. And a few years ago, suddenly we got something called an eye dal. We call beans dal. An eye dal. Now, eye dal, there's no dal with the name eye dal. We have moong dal and urad dal, and we have all kinds of dal. It turned out to be soya, flour, dyed yellow. And I think they use the term eye dal because they think like Apple can sell iPhones and iPads and iPods. Well, we can sell an eye dal and everyone will be thoroughly impressed. It was 25 rupees a kilogram compared to the dal which was selling at 150, and the women did not buy it. So if you don't believe, you're going to eat the real stuff. This has no taste, no flavor. We're not going to eat fiction. And that's what's happening to the agriculture system. We are being asked to eat fiction. The fiction of golden rice, the fiction of higher yields, the fiction of smart technology. We've got to eat real food. And real food comes from real seed. In India, when we sow seed, we pray. May the seed be exhausted. And seed is exhaustless. One little seed gives you 100 in a fruit, 1,000 in a grain, 1,000,000 in the millets. I call the millets forgotten foods. They're the most nourishing, they grow in the roughest context, they can resist any kind of climate change, and they're 40 times more nutritious than rice and wheat. The reason they call millets is because they give rise to 1,000,000 seeds. Look at the abundance. This abundance would create an end to hunger if we worked with that biodiversity. But it's that abundance that the industry is scared of. They're scared of nature's ability to provide abundance. They're scared of people's ability to be sovereign and self-reliant in their food production through agroecology and seeds in their hands. And that is why they're creating an artificial scarcity of seed. An artificial scarcity of seed, both legally and biologically. Legally, the scarcity is created by patenting, which prevents the farmers from saving seed, or new seed laws like UCOV, based on uniformity, which prevents you from having diversity in your land. Biologically, they're seeking to terminate the seed. The patents, Monsanto, Delta, and Pine, and USDA hold a patent on the terminator technology. Creation of genetically engineered sterile seed so no farmer could save seed ever and everyone would be dependent. So I say the prayer that Monsanto has is may the seed get exhausted, so that our profits are exhausted. And the profits are exhausted because the companies that sell the chemicals are the same companies that sell the seed. And very often, in the case of Syngenta, they're also the companies that sell the medicine. So your crop fails, you need more pesticides, they do very well. The farmer gets into debt. You get cancer because of toxics, they do very well, because they then send you a patented cancer drug. Now, I call these seeds of slavery because it's a system designed for total control. five companies wanting to control the seed supply and food supply of the world, not by bringing us better things, but by bringing us worse products and forcing it on us. In India, Monsanto managed to introduce GMO cotton. 95% of our cotton seed is now only controlled by Monsanto. Every Indian company is locked into licensing arrangements with them, they can't sell anymore. But BT cotton. Our public systems have been crippled. They don't supply seeds anymore, even though we had one of the best cotton research institutes. The price of seed jumped 8,000%. What was renewable and could be saved on the farm now had to be bought every year. It was supposed to control pests, but it created new pests. Aphids and jassets, 300 times more in the cotton fields. The result of which has been indebtedness of the kind that farmers can't pay back. It's a debt trap. And usually when the companies come to poor farmers, they say, well, this is going to be such a miracle, you earn so much and such high yields, you'll pay back the debt in a year. So the farmers innocently sign a paper for mortgaging their land and buy the seeds on credit. And it's the day the agents of the seed companies come to collect the land that the farmer will go quietly to the field, drink pesticide and end his life. 284,000 Indian farmers have committed suicide because of debt related to dependence on seed. There are no suicides in the areas where seed is in the hands of farmers. There's no suicide in an area where, with Nathania, farmers are practicing organic agriculture without external inputs. The third kind of pollution we witness with transgenics is the pollution of our democratic systems. Just like research is bored, politicians get bored. And they're usually very few. But because there's money behind them, their voices are very loud. The TV will have them, the newspapers will present them. And we have called them the clappers, you know, the emperor with no clothes. They're the ones who clap for the emperor's new clothes. And this political contamination of democracy, in my view, is the most serious threat that transgenics bring to us. Because they prevent our institutions from working on behalf of the people and on behalf of the earth. They manipulate them, they genetically modify them and turn them into mutants. So instead of being of the people, by the people, for the people, democracy is reduced being of the corporations, by the corporations, for the corporations. Monsanto wrote the global law on intellectual property. It wrote a law in the United States that said no court case could be brought against Monsanto. In India, our parliament did a study for 4 years on transgenics and said there's no role for them in India because we're a land of small farmers. Our Supreme Court appointed a technical expert committee of the top scientists of the country who said there should be a moratorium till we develop robust research on biosafety. There should never be herbicide-resistant crops introduced because herbicide-resistant means killing everything green that feeds us. It's only used for green deserts, where you spray from the skies and the plant you've made resistant survives. And the third thing they said was, no crop in which we are a center of diversity should be genetically manipulated because it will lead to genetic contamination. Now we are a center of diversity of rice, mainly covered with varieties. We're a center of variety of aubergine eggplant, which we call brinjal. And there was an attempt to introduce a BT eggplant to India by Monsanto. Starting in 2007, they started the trials. We built up a huge movement. And part of what we must do is celebrate. So we celebrated our eggplant, had feasts with 200 dishes made from different kinds of eggplants. And the pressure was so huge that the environment minister had to call public hearings. The first time a vegetable had public hearings. And the result of it was the environment minister realized that the scientists are saying no, citizens are saying no, farmers are saying no. There would always be a handful of 10 people at the back of the room in the same t-shirt that Monsanto had brought, who would say, you need transgenic. So a moratorium was put, and that moratorium is still in place. There are no crops in India besides GMO cotton. Which of course is a huge attempt, because of that political contamination, to undo the laws. We have a biosafety law, they want to undo it. To undo our democratic decisions, even undo our court decisions. This is lawlessness of the highest order. It's the introduction of a criminal economy against the will of people. So it is not just an issue of technology. It's just not an issue of saying, leave it to me, I'm the expert. When it comes to food, we are all experts. And we must all be decision makers. That is why we spread the movement for seed freedom and food freedom and knowledge freedom. Now, as I told you, the TRIPS agreement has been free trade, was a vehicle for spreading the dictatorship of corporations like Monsanto. It has nothing to do with freedom. It is about corporate dictatorship in the most vital areas of our life that make it illegal for us to do the things that we are obliged to do if we have to protect the earth, the biodiversity, our own health, our right to food, and the right to future generations. We've had, to beginning with the early days when I started the movement for seed saving, after the meeting where the industry laid out we will own the seeds of the world, and I hope there will be time to show a short video of what we do in India, because it's so similar to what the movements are doing here. But the first pledge we took was these seeds have been given to us by nature and by our ancestors. And we have a duty to hand over the diversity, integrity, and freedom of those seeds to future generations, just as we received it. And therefore, we will not obey any law that makes it a crime to perform our duty to the earth and to the future. Gandhi called this Satyagraha, the fight for truth. We have stopped every law that would make it a criminal activity to use your own seed by the use of satyagraha. I hope here in Costa Rica, your democratic processes and the election that you're going to have will avoid the struggle around transgenics by banning them forever, by implementing that law on the moratorium on GM corn. I know for sure the fact that so many young people and students are here means you've made your choice. And that choice needs to be heard. Your voice needs to be heard. But in case the political contamination and political pollution imposes laws and transgenics on you, laws that take away your seed freedom and food freedom and your knowledge freedom of your public university, then start planning the kind of actions that in the worst circumstances are the only way to defend freedom. Cooperating with life and truth and love. And making a deep commitment to say that this commitment to life and to freedom and to our knowledge will not be compromised. And therefore we have an obligation to not cooperate. becoming clear that when people have seed freedom, they grow better food and more food. They can practice agroecology, which is impossible in transgenics, which is impossible with chemicals. Agroecology produces more. We are now measuring an indicator called health per acre, not yield per acre, because yield measures monocultures. Biodiversity means something else. Biodiversity means the measurement of all the outputs, including the nutrition in our food. We have the capacity, by working with nature, to feed twice the human beings on this planet. Not that we need to, but we can create gardens of hope and paradise. Paradise that allows us to live well. Paradise that allows nature to live well. The last microorganism, the last butterfly, the last bee, to continue to evolve into the future. We don't have to opt or agree to the destruction of this paradise. The poison fields and the green deserts, which is all that the transgenic myth can offer us. Let's work and grow the paradise together.